Well, good morning, everyone. This is a different day in our church service. We really are focusing and trying to deal with some of the loss in this community. It's been really, really been tough as of late. We are always here to lift God and put God on the throne. We believe that He is the head of everything, and despite whatever grief that we are dealing with, that there's a plan in place. And so as we grieve this morning, as you guys think about the lost ones that we've lost, just be prayerful of people and be mindful of people. Figure out a way to love on people. Figure out a way to continue to love on those that you can, that are near you, near dear to you, right across the aisle from you. And as we just love on Jesus' name. So this first song is No Sweeter Name, in the name of Jesus. If you want to stand to your feet and join us, that'd be great.
You are the life to my heart and my and broken. You are the only truth and the
You will never leave me. I am not. Church, I invite you to pray with me. God, Sundays like this can be tough. Especially when we're still working through the grief that we're experiencing. God, it might be 2 weeks, it might be 2 years. And grief, God, it's a tricky thing because we can be sad and happy all at the same time and it doesn't make sense. And so, God, this morning we lean into you. We lean into you and your goodness and your grace and your love and your promises. God, this promise that we sang about this morning, that you will never leave us or forsake us, that you will be with us always to the very end of the age. God, remind us in those dark moments that we are not alone. God, may this service of worship and remembrance honor you above all else this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Church, you may be seated. Well, good morning and welcome to First United Methodist Church. We are so glad that you are here to worship with us this morning for our All Saints Day service. If you are online watching from wherever you are, I'd invite you to take a moment and go find a candle so that later on in the service when we participate in communion and our All Saints liturgy that you have a candle that you can light in remembrance of one of your loved ones. If this is your first time worshiping with us, I promise it's not always like this. So make sure that you're back here next week. But if you are a first-time visitor, we want to make sure that we get a chance to say hi and tell you about all the wonderful things that are happening here at First United Methodist Church. So if you would, after the service, go to the Connect Here sign, Deacon Jeannie would be happy to meet you and say hi. This week, we are going to be walking into our season of stewardship here at the church. And so be watching your mailboxes for your pledge cards and for a letter from our pastors just telling you about all of the wonderful things that have happened here at First United Methodist Church in the last year. As you begin to prayerfully consider what you're giving, what you're tithing, what that might look like in your life this year, we invite you to begin to consider that. And my last announcement, next Sunday, it's UMW Quilt Sunday. So make sure you get here early, otherwise you get the quilt that I made. And nobody wants that thing. So make sure that you're here, pick up a quilt, support the United Methodist Women and all of the ways that they are supporting the mission of the church. So it is time for our kiddos, I believe, to head out for Children's Sunday School. Church, have a great morning, and we'll be in prayer for all of you this morning.
In our Old Testament reading this morning, the prophet Isaiah gives us a vision of a day when death will be no more, where all people will be gathered together, and where God will wipe every tear from our eyes, a reading from Isaiah 25. On this mountain, the Lord of heavenly forces will prepare for all peoples a rich feast, a feast of choice wines, of select foods rich in flavor, of choice wines well refined. He will swallow up on this mountain the veil that is veiling all peoples, the shroud enshrouding all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Lord God will wipe tears from every face. He will remove his people's disgrace from off the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. They will say on this day, look, this is our God for whom we have waited. And he has saved us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let's be glad and rejoice in this salvation. In our New Testament reading, we hear once again about the joyful future that God has prepared for all God's people. A reading from Revelation 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. These are the words of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
So this last week, we had a big joy to celebrate in my extended family. Last Tuesday, my brother and his wife welcomed a new baby into their family. They had a little girl named, Aliana. I keep wanting to say it incorrectly. It's Aliana. Aliana, yes, there we go. Sorry if you guys are watching. Aliana, I promise I'll get it right before Thanksgiving. and she is just the sweetest little thing. We're all so excited to meet her over the holidays. And it's just such a joy to be able to be an aunt again and to have a new niece, especially because a couple of days before Aliana was born, I was talking on the phone with my mom. And we were talking about all of the other stuff that we've been dealing with in our extended family over the last several months. It's been a tough year, especially for that branch of our family. We've had some major illnesses and health events on mom's side, and my mom actually spent most of the month of October taking care of my grandma and my grandma's significant other, who was just recently diagnosed with a late-stage liver cancer. So there's just been a lot of extra grief and extra stress in the family recently, and when I was talking to my mom right before Aliana was born, she said to me, "Emily, I am just so ready to hold this baby. After the year we've had, we just need this. We need some hope and we need some joy. We need this baby." And today, as we celebrate All Saints Day, and as we remember those who have passed on from this life, I'm sure that a lot of you can relate to that sense of needing some hope and needing some joy. I know that I've said this a lot, and I'm kind of, you know, repeating myself for the millionth time this year, but the last year and a half, the last 19, 20 months or so have been really, really hard, and we have just been grieving a lot of things. And I think that having the normal kind of grief, like the grief we experience when we lose a loved one, I think that having that on top of all the other stuff that's going on in the world right now, having grief on top of the COVID stuff and the political division stuff and just the general uncertainty in the world, to have regular grief on top of all of that is just a lot. And I think that all of those extra layers make the regular grief even harder to navigate than normal. Because it's always hard to have a loved one in the hospital, but it's even harder when you can't visit them every day, or when you're not allowed to hug them. It's hard to have a parent or a spouse in a nursing home, but it's even harder when you can't visit them like you normally would, when you go months without getting to see them face to face. It's hard to lose someone who you care about, and it's even harder when your normal traditions and routines and way of life have been completely shaken up. I mean, all of that stuff just adds another layer of grief on top of an already painful situation. So it can feel like just one more thing, and it can be really, really heavy. And so I've found myself wondering recently, how we can find hope in these heavy times, whether it's in the middle of a pandemic or whether it's any other time in our lives. How do we find hope when our hearts are breaking? How do we keep ourselves from sinking into despair when it feels like we are just carrying the weight of the world on our shoulders? Those are big questions. And I think that the simplest answer is that our hope is found in the knowledge that we are not alone. That even in the midst of all of this, that God is with us. That God does not leave us, God does not forsake us, and God is walking this hard road with us. And this is good news. We need this. We need this message of hope, and we need this promise that we are not alone to sustain us when life gets hard. And I've been thinking about this a lot just in the last week or so. I've been thinking about how we can take care of ourselves and how we can sustain ourselves during times of grief. And the reason I've been thinking about it is because this last month or so, we have had quite a few memorials and funerals here at the church. And actually, a couple of people have asked me recently how pastors handle all of that, how we keep it together when death and grief and loss are such a significant part of our work. And the first time somebody asked me that question, it sort of surprised me just because I didn't really have an answer. I'd never really thought about it before. You know, it's part of the job, and so you do it, even when it's difficult. But I've been reflecting on that question a lot recently, and I think it's probably a combination of things that help us deal with it. And so I'd like to share with you very briefly some of my thoughts on that question, because I think that the things that help keep clergy relatively sane when we're helping people navigate grief and loss are things that can really apply to anybody. For example, one of the things that I think helps us a lot is the fact that even though there are tough things in ministry, there are also a lot of really joyful things as well. I mean, yeah, we have hard stuff that we need to do, but we also get to do baptisms. We get to hang out with the youth during confirmation classes. We get to pray and sing and worship God with amazing people every single week. And those joys can fill us up and sustain us. And I think that they give us strength to survive the hard parts. And that's not just a pastor thing. I think that's a life for everybody thing, for all of us, because we all experience this weird blend of joys and pains as we make our way through this life. We all experience loss, and we all encounter challenges and heartbreaks along the way. And yet, we also get to experience so much good stuff. We get to experience love and beauty and music and laughter and all the other things that make life worth living. And so I think that holding that strange balance can help us survive our grief. Just being aware of the little joys that pop up on a daily basis. And those joys don't erase the sadness. They don't magically eliminate the heartbreak. But what they can do is those little joys can give us a glimmer of hope when things feel dark. And sometimes that glimmer is enough to get us through. Another thing that I think helps me in particular handle funerals is that when it comes to the service itself, I navigate the grief by really focusing in on the stories and the whole celebration of life aspect. Because my main goal in a funeral or in a memorial service is to talk about the person's story, to tell their story one more time, while also talking about God's story and finding the places where their story and God's story intersect. I want to talk about how that person's life brought glory to God and how they used their gifts and their talents to serve God and to serve other people. And I just become more and more convinced that stories are a really crucial part of how we make meaning in this world and how we navigate both the good stuff and the bad stuff. And when we are experiencing a loss, there's a lot of power in telling our loved one's story. It might not be easy. It might make us cry a little or a lot, but that's okay. Telling those stories can still be a lifeline in the midst of grief, to just remember our person's story, to say their name and to tell other people about them. That act of storytelling can help us remember all the joy that our loved one brought us. We can talk about their quirks and their routines. We can remember their words of wisdom, and we can tell their favorite jokes. We can look back on their lives, and we can see all the ways that God was present in both big ways and little ways. And so I think that telling the story and seeing where God shows up can be a really important part of the healing process. I know it is for me. But the most important thing, the thing that we could not get through loss without, the thing that we really need is the promise of resurrection. I mean, at the end of the day, this is it. This is what keeps pastors going through all the terrible stuff, and I think it's what keeps all of us going. And I'll be honest, I have questions. I have things that I'm not completely certain about. I don't know what exactly the afterlife is going to look like. But I do know, without a doubt, that whatever it is, that God is there. And I know that God is good. And I know that in times of grief, I find myself hanging on really tightly to the promises that we heard in Isaiah and in Revelation. The promises that one day God will swallow up death forever and wipe away all the tears from our eyes. That one day we will get to experience eternal life in a place where there is no more sickness, no more sorrow, and no more pain. That one day we will indeed see that God has been making all things new, and that we get to be a part of that process, both in this life and in the life to come. That's where my hope and my trust is at the end of the day. And this morning, as we celebrate our saints who have gone on from this life, I also find a lot of hope in the reminder that the people who have gone on from this life are actually not all that far away. In the book of Hebrews, the Bible tells us that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, and that those who have left this earth are still cheering us on as we run the race of faith, and that they are still loving us from the other side of eternity. And one of the things that I think is really cool about our communion liturgy that we'll be reading through later today, that we always read when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, is that it says that whenever we come to this table, that we are praising God with all of God's people on earth and with all the company of heaven. That cloud of witnesses, that eternal congregation of Christians throughout the ages, they are with us when we receive the bread and when we drink from the cup. Those who have left this earth are still praising God into eternity, and we can remember them and connect with them and join them in worship whenever we come to the table of Christ. And that's why on All Saints' Day, I like to invite everyone to come to the table thinking about your loved ones who are now part of the company of heaven. Think about your parents, your grandparents, your siblings and friends and teachers and mentors, the people who changed your life and shaped your faith, and the ones who showed you God's love through their words and their actions. When you come to the table, I invite you to imagine them standing by your side, taking the bread and the cup with you. Because in a way, they are. Whenever we celebrate communion, we are joining in this sacrament with Christians in all times and in all places. And we are united with God and God's people, including those who are no longer here on earth. Friends, that's the good news for us today. That even when things seem dark and hopeless, and even when our grief feels too heavy to bear, we are not alone. God is here. God is here. And the ones who are gone from this earth, whenever we join together to praise God in worship, they are just a heartbeat away. And that's why today we get to give thanks for the saints who have gone before us. We give thanks for their witness and for their love and for their stories, which continue on into eternity. Thanks be to God. Amen.
As we enter into our time of prayer, we do have one prayer request. Please keep Joan Fallis' family in your prayers. Her daughter-in-law, Diane, passed away from a brain tumor this week. Now let us go to God in prayer. Almighty and gracious God, Emmanuel, God with us, we rejoice in the hope that you are with us, even in our time of grief. As we remember the saints who have gone before us today, as we still continue to grieve in sadness and in joy and in remembrance, we pray that your presence would be with us. That even in the midst of our grief, we know you are there. And we're not only surrounded by your presence, but by the presence of the cloud of witnesses, of those who have gone before us. We are not alone. And we give you thanks and praise that we are not alone. We are also surrounded by each other, by our family, our church family, our community. Help us to support each other. Help us to find the joy in the small things, to find the joy daily that we may be filled so that we can continue to show your love to others. We pray that we would tell the stories of those who have gone before us, and that as we tell those stories, we would see your presence in their lives. Fill us with your presence, that as we go forth from here, even in the midst of our grief, even in the midst of the trials and tribulations of life, that we would share your presence with those we encounter. And we pray all this in your Son's name, as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Before we enter into our time of giving back, we're going to have a time to hear from those who serve, why they serve. This week, we're talking about how to grow wide. We're going to hear from Don Scott about his service in congregational care and what that's meant to him. And we're going to hear from Dustin Riggett about how he plugs into our Serve Day planning team. As we go into next year, as you think about the ways that you're going to give back financially, we also want to think about the ways we share our time and our talents. And so we hear these stories so we can be inspired and encouraged to give back and grow wide. Dawn, if you'd like to come share, please.
Sometimes life is just a little dull, and we need a wow experience. It was less than 2 years ago that Kansas City Chiefs won the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Is that what you did when they watched that? Seems like a long time ago, doesn't it? I was a Milwaukee Braves fan for baseball when I was growing up as a kid. Haven't followed them very well since that time, but just a week ago, they won the World Series. I watched the last game on the television and watched those home runs go over the wall, and I said, yes. How about you? You need a wow in your life? A few years back, our pastoral staff and the church had a training session for those interested in outreach. About 20 members of our church were trained to visit church members who could not get out to our services, either confined to home or nursing home or hospitals for illness and age and health. We were to visit and send cards, maybe phone them, bring our church program and events to them. We become their friends. Donovan and I signed up. The plan was to visit once or twice monthly with a member to keep them in touch with our church program. I'm not a great nursing home fan and question my ability to be that kind of servant. Well, we volunteered and were assigned to a couple of people to visit. One was Annalise. She used to sit in the third row back here, little tiny short lady. When she'd drive down the road, you'd think the car was empty. You'd think, oh my goodness. She was so short, you couldn't see her. She lived in Germany, grew up in Germany during World War II. Her city was bombed by the U.S. They didn't have food. They had to leave the country and slip over into Persia. After the war, she met a occupation soldier from the U.S. named Dale, and he brought her back to America and to McPherson and to this church. She was assigned to us. She changed my idea of who ends up benefiting from these visits. I thought I was to bring a bit of sunshine to her dull life in the nursing home. Well, for over 3 years, it turned out she opened a window of light, love, and joy in my life. Her history in Germany during the war as a child, her trip to the U.S., their contribution of service to this church were all enlightening. But what really changed me was a spark in her eye. When she entered the room, we would go down the hall and look in the door, and she usually had a blanket clear up, and sometimes her eyes were closed, but usually they were open. And so I would point in and say, Annalise, how you doing? And she looked at me and said, well, pretty good. She said, have you been behaved better this week? That's a great way to open the conversation, isn't it? And that sly smile made my day. We'd spend 20 or 30 minutes with her, and then I'd say, well, Annalise, we're going to have to go. She'd say, well, next time we will have coffee. I always serve coffee to my guests. Do you like coffee? I said, yeah, I like coffee. We never had coffee, of course. But she was a true friend and brought a lot of light to my life. A couple Sundays ago, we made a special visit to a true friend in the hospital. She quite quickly informed us that she had been asked to be placed on hospice as her health required it, and she said, "I'm ready to go be with my Lord." What followed was a visit which covered many years of service to our church and community. We talked about the promise God made to his followers concerning eternal life. Pretty deep. After prayer, we left the hospital with a heavy heart, but glad we could have a part in God's plan. It wasn't a big yes moment, but it was a wow moment. This last Friday, we celebrated here in this sanctuary her entry into heaven. If you're interested in exploring the congregational care ministry and becoming a volunteer, becoming a friend and a visitor for our very special church members, please visit with Deacon Jeannie about how to become involved. You will find out it's a great way to get a wow in your life.
Good morning. So some of the ways that I've been able to serve in our congregation is I have ushered. I am part of the tech team on Sunday mornings. I get to help out with the youth groups on Wednesday, the middle school and high school, which I can't stand up here without mentioning what a fantastic group of youth that we have. It is a joy for me to get to be involved on a weekly basis in their spiritual lives. Another way that I've been able to serve our church is as a member of our Serve Day planning team. Prior to being on the Serve Day planning team, I looked at Serve Day. It was just a day that I showed up, got to wear jeans and a t-shirt to service, and went out and did a couple hours worth of painting or yard work on a Sunday. As part of the planning team, quickly realized that Serve Day doesn't just happen. There's a lot of planning and logistics and stuff that go into making that day a part of our lives. Some of those things involve project requests that come in. When a project request comes in, some member of that planning team goes out to that homeowner to determine kind of the scope of the project. What's included? What does the homeowner really need? What supplies need to be brought? This year, we had a request come in from a couple, and it was they needed their gutters cleaned out. Not a major project in the sounds of it, but I went out to evaluate, talk with the homeowner, determine what the need actually was. When there, I found out that this homeowner had recently tried to clean out their gutters themselves and had fallen from their ladder. They quickly realized that they'd reached the age where getting on a ladder and cleaning out the gutters themselves was no longer a great idea for them. So for weeks, this homeowner, he'd been stewing about, he'd always been able to tinker, do his own yard work, do his own home maintenance, and now he still had gutters that needed cleaned out, but he knew he did not have the physical ability to do that anymore. So when I showed up to talk with him, that let him know, hey, we had had this request come in, the joy that it brought to his face, even before we ever completed the project, just knowing he no longer had to worry about how this home maintenance project was going to get done, that he knew he wasn't able to do. It was just a neat experience to see that worry lift from him, knowing that our congregation was able to help. As we finished up Serve Day this year, we started talking as a group about what does Serve Day look like going forward? How can we do more good in our community besides just one day? So those are kind of ideas that we've looked at and are looking at for the next year of the rest of the year. What can we do to provide for our community? So if you've ever thought about being part of the planning team or have ideas or thoughts about some good things that we can do to provide for our community, I would encourage you to sign up to be part of the Serve Day planning team going forward. Thanks.
So you've heard about a couple of great options to plug in and grow wide. And there's even more options when we fill out our Serve Book next week that you'll see. So as we enter into our time where we give back a portion of what God has given to us, when the ushers come forward, I invite you during this time to think about how God is calling you to grow wide in your faith, grow wide in your reach, and how you can reach out to your neighbors, those that you work with, those in our community, and just listen to what God has in store for you. I invite the ushers to come forward.
Join with me in prayer. Generous God, we give you thanks for all that you have given us. Our treasures, our time, the talents that you have poured out in our lives. We ask that you would continue to bless our gifts and utilize them and utilize us as you continue to grow your kingdom here on earth. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. We invite you now to join with us in our communion liturgy as we prepare to gather at God's table, at the table of Christ. Your part will be on the screen, as we are celebrating communion, as we are preparing to celebrate communion, we will also be remembering some of our saints who have passed away in this last year. And when it's time to come forward and light candles and receive communion, we'll give you some further instructions. But for now, please join us in the words on the screen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise. This morning, we give you thanks for all your saints throughout the ages and for the gifts that they have given us, for Abraham and Sarah, who give us courage to journey into unknown territory.
For Miriam and Moses, who give us courage to lead God's children to freedom.
For Ruth and Jeremiah, who give us courage to risk ourselves for God's plan of hope.
For John the Baptist and Mary Magdalene, who give us courage to bear witness to the God of life.
For Paul and Priscilla and all the saints who give us courage to be Christ's church in this place.
We give you thanks.
For your people in all ages and the whole company of heaven, we give you thanks and join in their unending praise, saying,
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, the firstborn of the dead, who shows us the way to eternal life. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. That's why today we remember how, on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to all to drink, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
O God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, who is the source of salvation for both the living and the dead. And we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here, that we might be united in praise and thanksgiving with all those who have gone before us. Renew our communion with your saints, especially those whom we name before you now.
Bruce Peterson. Mildred Hodson. Minnie Atkinson. Charles Regier. Donna Lehner. Tim Wislowski. Robert Duran. Mary Lois Kenton. Brett Adcock. Libby Spate. Marilyn Stouffer. Carl Motz. Ruth Metlin. Keith Mines. Annalise Stewart.
Jim Boyer. Marilyn Huber. Amanda Gunn. Hunter Emerson, Barbara Powell, Dean Elliott, Virginia Martin, Ronnie Jantz, Brian Minier, Jackson Schrader, Aileen Eaton, James Winslow, Jody Domba Miller, Wayne Chartier, and Barbara Eberle.
Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses,
strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith.
By your Spirit, make us one with each other and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. I'd like to invite those who are helping to serve communion forward at this time. And as we prepare to receive, I would like to remind you of a couple of things. First of all, that the Lord's table is an open table. We trust that when Jesus invited all of his disciples to this place, even the ones who would betray him or deny him, even the ones who would run away from him, we trust that because he was willing to feed them, that he's willing to feed us all. And so you do not need to be a perfect person to come to this table. If you did have to be a perfect person, none of us would be here. You do not have to be a member of this church to receive communion. You do not have to be a United Methodist. This table is open to all of God's people. And so, in a few moments, the ushers will be inviting you forward by row. We're going to have two stations, one on each side. As you come to receive communion, we also invite you to grab one of the candles from the tables that are up here. After you receive communion, you can light a candle. Myself and Deacon Jeannie will be down there holding a couple of flames. You can light a candle and remember your loved one or your loved ones, whoever you are holding close to your heart this year. And as you do so, I invite you to remember that they are not far away and that you are not alone. Let's come to the table. The feast is ready.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome. The grave.
There's a day that's drawing near, when the darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my face shall be my eyes.
Jesus has overcome. The grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No.
Voice of many angels sing.
when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. I will rise. I will
Let us pray. Holy God, we give you thanks for all your saints, for all the men and women and children who have served your church with faithfulness, boldness, and courage. And we thank you for this holy mystery, for coming to us in bread and cup, uniting us as one body with all your people throughout time and space. As we go from this place, may we walk in the footsteps of all those who have gone before. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, through the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand as you are able and join us in our closing song, How Can I Keep From Singing?
How can I keep from singing your praise. How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King. Troubled times, sing when I win. I can sing when I lose myself and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up, sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call to you in prayer.
And the people who we loved here on earth are not that far away. Our love for them continues. Their love for us continues. Go in comfort. Go in strength. Knowing that you are not alone and that God is walking this road with you. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart
times.
Sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call to you in prayer. I can sing my last breath, sing, for I know that I'll sing with the angels and the saints around the throne. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your praise? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I am loved.
to sing.